all, this is Charishweta Devi from Indie Times, which is an official magazine page of CEG, AC Tech and SAP of Anna University. Here we have a palette series. The series sets lights on the journey and inspiration of design professionals, which would be inspiring for many new budding artists. With us, we have Varsha, an architect by profession, and she is passionate about ceramics and pottery. Welcome, ma'am. Please introduce yourself.
Hi, it's so nice to be here. Thank you so much for having me. And as you were saying, yes, I am an architect. I graduated from NIARC, Academy of Architecture, in 2016. And I've been practicing pottery alongside that during the weekends. So I started learning pottery sometime in 2015. And it's been, you know, kind of going along with architecture since then. So a little bit about myself, I'm basically born and brought up in Chennai. So, yeah, and I have my studio here in
Teenagar. Oh, that's nice. Usually, designers are portrayed as pencil artists, watercolor designers, and graphic designers. What made you choose this career?
Okay, that's an interesting question. I would say that as an architect, we get to design a lot of different things. We get to design buildings, we get to design interiors, sometimes we get to design furniture and a lot of things that are associated with a building or a house as such. So how it works is we design something and then somebody else executes it. So if I design a furniture, I will make the drawings, I'll design it, I'll decide how I want it to look, and then a carpenter will come in and make that piece for me. But what attracted me towards pottery is the possibility that I can not only design something, but I can also make it by myself. So the role of a designer-maker is what I found very alluring about pottery, and that's what got me excited to start.
Okay, very amazing reflexes. Tell me about the time when you thought about making this as a business. Which time you started to do this business?
I'm sure that you will hear this from a lot of different artists these days, but it was actually during the lockdown that I had a bit of time to take this forward. So right after college, pottery was something that I was doing more as a weekend hobby in my free time, because I've always had a full-time job. So pottery was something I was doing alongside that. It was only during the lockdown that I had the time to think, okay, what do I want to do with this whole pottery thing? What is the future that I see for it? What is the possibility or the potential that I see in pottery? So how do I want to take it forward? And that 6 months, I think, was a good time to really think about it, strategize, set up the website, and share my work on a more serious note.
Okay, ma'am. Like a lockdown chef, you are a lockdown architect.
Yeah. Lockdown potter.
Okay, ma'am. Could you walk us through your studio now?
Yeah, sure. All right. So just a bit of background about my studio. It's actually, my mom runs a school for dyslexic children called Deeksha Learning Center. And she's been doing this for the last 30 years or so. So because, again, during the lockdown, the schools were all closed.
Yes.
So she said, okay, Varsha, you can take one room and have your studio there. So I'll just show you guys. It's literally just one room, but that's enough for me. So, waiting. Yeah.
Yes.
Are you able to see the wheel?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So that's the wheel. It's an electric wheel. And you just have to plug it into any normal 3-pin socket. And it's quite small, as you can see.
Yes.
And right opposite the wheel, you can't really see, but I have a mirror against the wall so that as I'm making something on the wheel, I can see, how it's coming out. Because I'm so close to the piece, so a mirror really helps me to see if what I'm making is proper. And so that's the wheel, and that's the door to my studio. And here, I'm not sure if you can see, I have a bunch of buckets here, a bunch of tubs.
Yes.
Is it visible?
It is visible, ma'am.
Yeah, so these are the glazes actually. So these are the chemicals and the materials which you apply on the pot to give it that glossy finish or the colored finish. So as you can see, I have so many different colors. And And on this side, I have another table with a lot of tools and a lot of other things. But that's it. That's my studio. That's all you need, basically.
Yes, yes. Very small, but it's very organized.
Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am. What was the responses you were got from your family and close circles after you revealing this as a business?
Okay, so actually it's an interesting story because when I was doing pottery more like a weekend hobby, they were very supportive, you know, they were so interested, like, wow, how is she, you know, how does she even have the talent to do something like this? They were very supportive and, you know, they were just as excited as I was. But when I said, no, I want to buy a wheel, I want to have a studio in the house, you know, I want to kind of, you know, take this a little bit more seriously, then they were scared. They're like, you know, what is she saying? Has she lost her mind? Like, you know, she needs to, she's already so busy in her job. How is she going to have the time to do this? And is she going to end up investing a lot of money? And, you know, it's not going to work out. So initially they were very supportive, but when I said that I want to scale it up, I want to take it one step further, then they had a lot of doubts and questions, and I could sense that they were not so sure of what I was doing. But slowly, as they saw how passionate I was and they started seeing that I actually know what I'm doing, they became a lot more supportive again. So if you see on my website or on my Instagram, my dad is the one who models all the pieces for me. So, and my mom is the one who is giving me this space. So as you know, now their whole perspective has shifted completely. Might have to excuse me for 1 second. So sorry.
No problem.
Yeah. So as I was saying that, you know, initially they were very supportive, but eventually that changed. And once they started seeing that I was actually very serious about this, that I had a plan in mind and that I knew what I was doing, they became more supportive. So I would say that when you're doing something very different, like pottery, nobody is going to have a complete picture of it the way you have as an artist. Nobody is really going to understand the whole thing the way you understand it. So, but don't let that stop you from doing what you want to do. You know, you have to believe in yourself. You have to have the clarity as to what exactly you're doing, and eventually it will make sense to everybody else. So that was my learning from the whole response that I got from my family.
Okay, thank you for your family to encourage you, because you having interview with me this session is thank you for your parents only.
Yeah, exactly. They're the ones that give me the studio and everything.
So,
yeah.
Okay, that's nice. What you have done to develop your knowledge regarding this pottery so far?
Initially, when I started out, I had to go learn in another studio. I had to sort of, you know, take some classes over the weekend and everything. But I would say, maybe this sounds like a very typical answer, but I would say that these days, knowledge is available to everybody, everywhere. You know, whether you're on Instagram or on Pinterest or just online or books, libraries, you know, whatever you want, there's a wealth of knowledge available. So, yes, I did go to a class, but there's only so much that somebody else can teach you. I think that a lot of it has to do with your own quest for knowledge, your own curiosity, your own, you know, the love of learning. You know, you should have that freedom to explore and that need to learn more and more. And the minute you say, I want to learn, the knowledge is all around you. You know, frankly speaking, I learned a lot by watching other potters on YouTube. You know, the way they make the pieces, the way they keep their hands, you know, how much water do they use. So anything and everything, you can always find a place to learn it from. And other than that, on a more serious note, I did attend a lot of workshops by different studios. I attended a few workshops in Bangalore, and during the lockdown I attended a lot of virtual classroom sessions and a lot of online courses. So that's the thing. I mean, all you need to have is the drive to learn. And literally the knowledge is all around you. There are so many free resources as well. So yeah, and pottery is somewhere where, you know, you're always learning. You can spend a lifetime learning pottery. So I would never say that I already know everything. You know, that's not possible. So it's a continuous journey. So I have learned to always keep an open mind and make sure I'm learning something with every single pot that I make.
Okay. Curiosity and love for learning is your mantra, right?
Yes, absolutely. You said it.
Thank you, ma'am. I am able to follow that now onwards.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Have you faced any challenges or conflicts regarding this pottery?
That's a good question. See, because pottery by itself is, it's not as easy as it looks. I think that initially when you start learning, it's actually quite frustrating because, you know, it's so different, right? You have a wheel, it's spinning in front of you, and then there's this clay, and you have to make it do what you want, and it's not going to listen to you just like that. You know, you really have to understand how to work with it, what's the right way, what's the right technique. So it can be very frustrating, but once you get past that, it's really nice. So learning pottery itself was a big challenge. You know, it takes a lot of time. And other than that, of course, there is everybody else's perspective of it, like, oh, what is she doing, you know, what is this, or, you know, people don't get it, like, initially. So that's the second thing. Third thing is, it's quite expensive, to be very honest. Like, you know, obviously, you have to buy a wheel, you have to buy clay, you have to buy all of these glazes, you have to buy a kiln. It's not cheap. And I would say that's why it has taken me so long, even to build this small tiny studio, it has taken me 5 years. Because it is like whatever I would earn from my job, I would save something and buy one little piece of equipment for my studio, or I would buy, you know, 10 kilos of clay. Or it was a very step-by-step progression. So that was very tough. Like, you know, really putting the resources together to set up a studio was very tough. So there have been challenges all along the way. And even last week I posted on Instagram about how some pieces broke in my kiln. So this happens all the time. But I would say that pottery has taught me not to let failure get me down. Simply because, you know, you never know if it's going to turn out right or not. So pottery has kind of taught me, you know, it's okay, mistakes happen, you know, you deal with it and you move on. So, and I think now I've gotten to the point where I feel like I love this medium so much that no matter what challenge comes in the way, I'm going to keep doing it. Like, I cannot stop doing this, you know. So I think that's a very valuable lesson I've learned from pottery.
Yes, that's a spirit to do any business, I think so.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, ma'am. How do you balance your part-time pottery business, family, and as an architect?
Again, I would say, you know, see, this is just me being very honest. When I was learning it more like a hobby, it was a fun thing, you know. It was like, oh, I would just go to these classes on the weekend for 1 or 2 hours, and it was very relaxing, it was really nice. But when I bought my own wheel, it was very tough. Like, because architecture by itself, I've always been in some full-time job or the other, always, ever since I graduated, even now. But I would say that an architecture is a tough job. It's a tough job. You have a lot of late nights. Sometimes you're working through the weekend, you're working on Sundays. That's just how it is. So it was very tough to find the time for this. You know, I think, to be completely honest, I think since 2017, I don't think I've had a weekend where I did nothing. Yeah, because that's just how demanding it is. Your job is demanding, pottery is demanding. So it's not easy, that's what I'm trying to say. And you know, at least till 2020, I was doing it for fun. So even if I go 1 or 2 weekends without doing pottery, it would be okay. But now I'm fulfilling orders, I have clients, I'm answerable to them. So it's very hectic sometimes. But I would still say it's worth it. It's okay. I strongly believe that this is the age to work hard. This is the age to, you know, to really give it everything you've got. And I think that these 10 years, say 20 to 30, if you really slog it out, then your future is kind of set. So it's tough. And, you know, a lot of the times I don't get to hang out with my friends, or I have to miss out on a few family trips but I would still say it's okay, you know, it's fine. So,
okay.
There's a reason I'm doing this.
Okay, ma'am. Has social media helped the art community gain recognition and to reach?
Absolutely, yes. I would definitely say so. Especially, I think last year there's been a surging interest in pottery. All of a sudden, you know, a lot of people are talking about it. A lot of people want to learn. And I think social media has definitely contributed to that in a big way. Because pottery is actually very interesting to watch. It's really relaxing to watch.
The process is very interesting to watch.
Yeah, like, you know, you have a lump of clay and in 5 minutes, it's a bowl or it's a cup or it's a tumbler or whatever. So it's quite magical in a way. Social media has definitely helped a lot. And even for me as an artist, to reach a lot of people, to reach the right kind of people, to reach like-minded people, it has definitely helped. But I always believe that social media is kind of a double-edged sword. You know, there are a lot of good things, but there are also a lot of bad things. You tend to compare yourself. You tend to, you know, get so carried away looking at the things that are happening in other people's lives. And, you know, it's very important to not let that get to you, I think. So it's kind of a balance. You have to strike a balance, I think.
Yes, this same social media have helped us to reach to you now.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, ma'am. How do you feel with the art blocks?
I'm in a creative profession, so it's a big problem sometimes, you know, when you have a deadline, but you're not happy with the work that you've done and you're not able to produce better work. Creative blocks are quite a big problem. So I would say that one thing that I've understood about myself is, if I try to push myself at that time, it's not going to work. You know, I have to understand that I'm not a machine. I'm not some mechanical piece of equipment that's just producing something. I'm a human with emotions, with feelings, with creativity and passion. And I have to be kind to myself. So if I'm not at my creative best, it's okay. It's fine. I know that at that point, when I reach that point, I need to take a break. I need to slow down, I need to calm down, maybe just step away from the work for a day or two, and then when I come back, it'll be fine, the problem will solve itself. So I would say that's the attitude that has helped me the most.
Yes, it is very sweet to hear this. Then your advice for upcoming artists?
Firstly, I don't believe in advice, because I think that everybody's journey is different. Everyone is a different kind of person. You know, everyone has their own personality. What I can tell you is what has worked for me personally and what hasn't worked for me. So the first thing, the big thing that worked in my favor was really taking my time with pottery. You know, as I was saying to you, from 2015 to 2020, I was practicing pottery just for the sake of it. I didn't have any clue what is this going to do for me in the future. Can I make money from this? Can I not make money from this? I was just doing it simply because I loved the medium so much and I wanted to learn more, I wanted to explore. So I would say take that time when you're young. When you discover that you're good at something, spend time to learn your craft. You know, really get into it. And it's important to do this when you're young, because when you're young, you have a very fresh perspective on things. You know, you're not already bogged down by what everybody else is doing or what everybody else is saying. You know, you're very fresh, you're very new. And with that fresh perspective, you have to get into your craft and you have to say, what do I want to do with this craft? What are my beliefs? What are my principles? You know, so that five-year period where I was just learning the medium was a very precious time for me. And so that's my first piece of advice. Take the time to get really good at something that you're already good at. You know, take your time to gain that knowledge, to gain that technical mastery, and then think about the next step. You know, take that time to practice the art just for art's sake. That's the biggest thing that has worked for me, which I feel I should share. The second thing that I would say is, you know, again, the second thing that I would say is again, it's kind of, you know, taking off from my first point is, don't be in a hurry to put yourself out there, you know. Don't be in a hurry to say, oh, I need to take this business and start making money with it, or that, you know, I have to gain X number of followers on Instagram, or I have to, you know, don't put that pressure on yourself. Just take your time, get really good at something, and eventually everything will happen. Eventually you will make money, eventually you'll be famous, whatever. But don't let that not be your immediate focus, you know. Don't be in a hurry to put yourself out there. I would say that's the second thing. Another reason I'm saying that is because, you know, social media it doesn't give you the complete picture or the complete truth of someone's journey. I would say that it also requires a very different set of skill sets, a different part of you. You know, when you're on social media, you have to be outgoing, you have to be extroverted, you have to be focused on engaging with other people. But when you're creating, you have to be introspective, you have to be with yourself, it's just you and the art. So it requires two very different attitudes, I would say. So focus first on mastering your art, and eventually you can think about how you want to share it with the world and all of that. So that's the second piece of advice. The last thing that I would like to say is, don't ever let anyone make you feel bad for your starting point. Please don't. Like, if you want to be an artist and all you have is a piece of paper and a pencil, that's fine. If you want to be a singer, you don't have to have the best recording equipment. You just have to sing. And, you know, I would say that when you're an artist, the only thing that matters is the passion in your heart, the knowledge in your head, and the capability in your hands. You know, nothing else matters. These are the only things that matter. So even me, look at me, I'm in a borrowed space. It's a one-room studio, but I'm doing what I have to do. So don't ever let anyone make you feel bad that you don't have something, or that you don't have a big space, or you don't have a fancy phone. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, your talent is what matters. Especially as kids, I think we tend to feel that pressure a lot, like, you know. But just take it easy, start with what you have. That's important, and everything else will find its way to you eventually. You know, so these are the
advices. These are the best advices to artists and to all, I think so. So thank you for your time, Varsha. I am so glad to speak with you. I am very inspiring because of you. Our team has amazed at your works on the Instagram and to reach you. Thank you for your time. In this hectic schedule, you are giving a time slot for us to take an interview. Thank you so much for that.
It was my pleasure. I had such a nice time talking to you.
Okay, Varsha. I am appreciating, and I am so hope that congratulations for your career, future career.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Varsha. Have a great time and great day.